Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, we have seen the basic mechanism of boiling and various types of boiling. We have seen that the two boilings are more important, that is pool boiling and flow boiling. In this topic, we are going to talk about the flow boiling. In the flow boiling, there can be a scenario that is, one is vertical boiling or the horizontal boiling. So basically, flow boiling is also categorized as the forced convection boiling. Now let us consider the vertical scenario. Now let us say that there is a tube and the heat is given to the wall of the tube or to the tube container, the heat is transferred. Now the second thing is, let us say that a fluid is passed through the tube with some temperature, let's say T saturated. So what will happen? Initially, small bubbles will be formed. Okay. Now this region they call as a bubbly region. So basically, in case of a flow boiling, we have got total four regions. One is bubbly region, then the sludge, annular, and then finally the mist region. So what is happening in the bubbly region? The small droplets are formed. See, as you can see from this diagram, as I have said before, there are four types of regime that is formed: bubbly, sludge, annular, and mist. Now in this topic, we are going to more focus on the bubbly region. So if this is the bubbly region, what is happening over here? Initially, there is a single phase liquid that is passing through this. As you are giving heat to the fluid, what is happening? Initially, there is a partial boiling. So this partial boiling is what they call as ONS. Now what is ONS? We have seen this before. ONS is nothing but onset of nucleate boiling. So this is where the nucleate boiling may have started. Then comes the bubble size have grown in its size. So this they call as a fully developed boiling. So they call this as FDB, fully developed boiling. And then we have got a significant void flow. Now in this, these bubbles have not only formed on the surface of the wall of the tube, they have grown in its size and then they have started moving in the upward direction. So basically in this region, enough void is formed. So that is why they call this as a significant void flow region. So this entirely can be called as a bubbly region. Now after the bubbly region, as the void fraction reaches approximately 0.1, means out of 100, 10% is occupied by the vapor or the steam itself if the fluid is water, then the bubbles have grown in its size and the number of bubble will start collecting itself. Then we call this as a sludge formation. So sludges are nothing but a bigger bubbles. So this sludge formation will take place. The heat transfer is by the single phase forced convection in case of a single phase liquid. So till this area, we only have a single phase forced convection liquid. Then from the bubbly region to some part of a sludge region, we have a nucleate boiling. So this is the heat transfer is predominantly due to the nucleate boiling in this region. So what happens after the sludge flow? After the sludge flow, these sludges also will start collecting themselves and then they will start forming a annular flow. Now what is annular? So annular flow is given, the name of the annular flow is given for this region because it looks like the shape itself looks like an annular. So here a ring, annular ring is formed and the diameter of the annular ring will keep on increasing. If the annular ring is somewhat like this, at this length from the inlet, the diameter has increased as we have moved in the upward direction. So this region is basically they call as the annular region. Now in this region, as you can see, the small droplets are there in between and then only a thin layer of fluid will be there covered onto the wall of the tube. The heat transfer is predominantly by the forced convection evaporation in this region. Now comes the dry out. Now what is dry out? The dry out is a place where there is maximum annular ring that is formed. Means there is no surface onto the pipe that will be covered by the fluid. So the entire region we will have a only the steam. So here the dispersed droplet form flow will be there. Now this they called as the mist flow. Now why mist flow? Because in this case there will be a vapor, and then in the vapor itself there will be a small droplets. So that is why they call this as the mist flow. Obviously the heat transfer is predominantly by the dispersion flow film boiling. Then once I reach to a certain height, we will have no water droplets. So in this case we will have a superheated steam that is coming out from this region, and obviously there will be a single phase vapors beyond the mist flow, and the heat transfer is predominantly by the single phase forced convection vapor. Now let us talk about the temperature. How does the temperature vary? Initially the temperature of wall, so this line indicates the temperature of wall, this line indicates the temperature of fluid. Both of them keep on increases till the value of x is zero. Now once a single bubble is formed, once the dryness fraction has increased from 0 to let's say 0.001, then what happens? The delta T will never change. Means the temperature of water as well as the temperature of wall will remain same. Till what point? Till the dry out is reached. So basically the temperature here, let's say in case of water, if the pressure is let's say 1 bar, then once I reach to 100 degrees Celsius, that is at 100 degrees Celsius, we will have a first bubble that is formed. There is no increase in the temperature. So the delta T will remain same, and once the dry out is reached, suddenly the wall temperature will climb up because the heat transfer rate, that is H for the vapor, is very low as compared to the H for the liquid. Hence, the heat transfer rate is suddenly reduced at this region because the surface is exposed to the vapor in this case after the annular flow, that is at dry out. Hence, the wall temperature will suddenly increase, and then maybe it will again gradually start decreasing. But again, you can see the decrease won't be high enough. Then what will happen with the temperature of fluid? The temperature of fluid will remain almost same, and then once we have reached to a mist flow, or once we have reached to a single phase vapor, the temperature of fluid will again start increasing. Now this is similar to what we have seen in case of a TH diagram. If this is the TH diagram, then we know that this is the diagram that we draw. So in this region there is no change in temperature. This is the same region that we have over here. There is no change in temperature for the fluid, only the temperature of wall will keep changing. Similar study can be done for the horizontal one. Again, for the horizontal, the only difference will be the gravitational force won't be a dominant one here. One more thing that we need to discuss is that in case of a pool boiling, we only depend on the buoyant force for the movement of the bubble. But in case of the flow boiling, the buoyant force and the external force will also come into picture. Why these two forces are there? Because the buoyant force is obviously due to the existence of the bubble, and the external force is due to the velocity that we are providing to the fluid flow itself. Similar to the vertical flow, the horizontal flow can be categorized in the same regimes, that is single flow liquid, then bubbly flow, then comes the sludge flow, the annular flow, and then the mist flow. Beyond the mist flow there will be a single phase vapor. Now in this diagram they have basically given us the variation of heat transfer coefficient with respect to the length of the pipe. How does the heat transfer coefficient increases? So as you can see that initially it was constant for a single phase fluid, then between the nucleate boiling, So this is basically the onset of nuclear boiling. The value of H has increased. And then the value of H will keep on increase gradually till it reach to a dry out point. So at the dry out point, we will have the maximum H value. And after the dry out point, as we have said before, the value of H suddenly decreases. This is seen by the increase in temperature in case of a vertical diagram. And then the value of H will gradually increase after this point. So why is the sudden decrease in the value of H? Because after this point, till this point, a liquid layer is continuously in contact with the surface. But after this, there is no liquid layer that will have in contact with the surface. It is only the gaseous or the steam or the vapor will be there. And the value of H for the vapor is quite low as compared to the value of H for the liquids. So where is the use of this flow boiling? The flow boiling is used in many power plant, in many boilers. One of the important use is in case of a nuclear power plant. In nuclear power plant, we generally keep a fuel. We keep a fuel bundle, and around this fuel bundle, we will have to let the water or any given fluid pass through this fuel bundle. Now these fuel bundles are kept vertical, okay, and then we need to know till what height the dry out will take place in this case. So to increase the heat transfer coefficient, we need to have a good understanding of a flow boiling. So such as this, there are so many other applications of the flow boiling that we can see in the industry. Now that is it in this topic. In this topic, we talked about the force convection boiling or flow boiling for vertical and horizontal pipe. We have also talked about its application in the industry. Thank you for watching this video. Please stay tuned with Ekeeda and subscribe to Ekeeda. Thank you.